Halo, kita lanjutkan persiapan matematika ASEAN Scholarship untuk entry level secondary 3. Kali ini akan dibahas contoh soal O-level Singapura. Selamat menyaksikan.
Hello everyone, so today we'll be going through five questions. This time it's for O-level secondary school. So let's start right away. So the first question will be this question six right here. And in this question we have a regular hexagon. So this right here, regular hexagon and equilateral triangle. So just to recap, regular hexagon means that each of these sides are equal. And equilateral means each of these sides are equal. And we also know the ratio of the perimeters, which is 1 to 2. And we know we want to find the ratio of the areas. So the first thing I'm going to do here, I'm going to label this side as x. So I'm going to label the length to be x. So we know that the perimeter of the hexagon would just be equals to 6 times x, so 6x. And we know the ratio, so the perimeter of the triangle would be 12x. So each of the sides would be equals to 4x. And I'm going to use an important property of the regular hexagon, which is that each of these triangles are equilateral triangles. And this is easily provable as long as you know that each of these sides are equal, and you know that this is 60 degrees. So I'll leave that as a self-exercise, but for now, let's just focus on the question. So since these triangles are equilateral, we would also know that this length right here would also be equals to x. And now I'm going to use the sine formula to get the area of the triangle, which is half times AB times sine alpha. So to get the area of one triangle, that would be half times x squared times root 3 over 2, which is sine 60. So this is equals to root 3 over 4 x squared. So that's the area of one triangle. To get the area of the whole hexagon, you just need to multiply this by 6. So 6 times root 3 over 4 x squared is the area of the hexagon, which simplifies to 3 over 2 root 3 x squared. And you do the same for the triangle. So the ratio of the area of the triangle would actually be half times 4x squared times root 3 over 2. And this will give you 4 root 3 x squared. So the ratio would eventually simplify out into 3 to 8. Okay, so now for question 2, we're going to take a look at question 10 right here. So it's a quadratic expression, and we want to express x squared plus 9x minus 4 in the form of x plus q squared plus p. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to first expand out x plus q squared plus p into x squared plus 2qx plus q squared plus p. And what I'm going to do here is I'm going to compare the coefficients of x in this as well as this. So if we compare the coefficients in form 2, I'm going to label this as 1 and 2. In the second one, the form is 2q, and in the first one, the form is 9. The coefficient is 9. So we actually know that 2q is equal to 9, and we can immediately solve for q. So q is just 4.5. And next is we need to find out what p is. And we can do that by also comparing the coefficient of the constants. So in the first one, the constant is minus 4, and the second one, the constant is q squared plus p. And we already know what q squared is. So minus 4 is equals to 4.5 squared plus p. So p is equals to minus 4 minus 4.5 squared, which is just minus 24.25. So we can immediately write this x squared plus 9x minus 4 as equal to, sorry, minus 4. As equals to x plus 4.5 squared minus 24.25. And for part B, we want to write down the coordinates of the minimum point of the graph x squared plus 9x minus 4. So this is where we can notice the the use of having this form. Notice that x plus 4.5 squared is actually always less, more than or equals to 0. So the minimum value of x plus 4.5 squared is actually 0. And if we add on x plus 4.5 squared minus 24.25, the minimum value would actually be minus 24.25. And this value would occur when x is equal to minus 4.5. So when x plus, it, this value occurs when x is minus 4.5. So the minimum point is just minus 4.5 and minus 24.25. For the third question, we're going to take a look at question 19, where we first need to simplify 3 multiplied by 3x plus 2y minus 5 multiplied by x minus 3y. So this is a simple expansion. So we're first going to expand the first part, which is 9x plus 6y minus 5x plus 15y. And we're just going to simplify this into 4x plus 21y. So that's the first part. And for the second part is the more interesting. And this is actually a very common question that comes up in nearly every O levels. And this is factorizing a sort of complicated equation with 4 different combinations of variables. So what I'm going to do here is I'm first going to simplify as best as I can. So this is the strategy where we just try to simplify and see where it goes. So I notice here that these two have a common factor of a. And actually, they also have a common factor of 3 because 12 and 9 both share 3 as a factor. So I'm going to factorize out 3a. And this will give me 4b minus 3x. And minus 8by plus 6xy. And I can actually simplify this part now, which is minus 8by plus 6xy. And I notice that there's a common variable, which is y. So I can factor those out. And I can actually also factor out 2, because 8 and 6 share 2 as a common factor. So I'm going to make it into 3a, 4b minus 3x. And I'm going to factor out minus 2x. So this is because I saw negative in front, so I'm just going to factor out minus 2x. Not minus 2x, it's minus 2y. And this will become 4b minus 3x. And this actually comes out nicely because notice that these two share the common factor of 4b minus 3x. So I can actually combine these two expressions into one. 3a minus 2y multiplied by 4b minus 3x. And for this question, it actually works out quite nicely, but most of the time, they might change around the orders of the expressions a bit, and which makes it a bit confusing. So the strategy is actually to just try out different orderings. That's usually the fastest way to solve the question. For the next question, we're actually going to go back to question 13. And the question has a formula, which is y is equal to 16 minus 4x squared. The first part is very simple. It's just simple substitution, where to find y when x is minus 2, we just substitute minus 2 into the formula. So 4 times minus 2 squared, and this would just be equals to 0. And now we need to rearrange the formula so that x is the subject. To do this, and actually, what this means is that we want to make sure that the formula is x equals something something with y inside the formula instead of y equals something something. So that's what it means to make x the subject. And to do this, we first need to actually move all of the x, all of the expression with x in it into the left side. So this becomes 4x squared is equals to 16 minus y. So we essentially swap these two around. And I'm going to remove the coefficient of x by dividing both sides by 4. So this will become 16 minus y over 4. And finally, we're just going to root both sides. And remember that there's a plus minus next to the root, because both positive and negative values of y of x is possible, since we only know the x squared. So that's the final answer. For the last question, we're actually going to look at an explanation question. So in O level, sometimes we have these questions where there's not really any math. It's just explanation and interpretation of graphs. Here we have a graph on newspaper circulation. So how much newspaper is being circulated around? And the question is asking what the misleading feature of the graph is. And if you notice, this graph actually has a misleading y-axis, because it started off as at 1.2 million instead of 0. So we're not actually getting the full representation of the graph. So the misleading feature is that the y-axis begins at 1.2 million instead of 0. You can also say that the range of the y-axis is too small. That's also a valid explanation of the misleading feature. And so how does this feature affect each interpretation? What actually makes it look as if the fall in newspaper circulation is much bigger than it actually is? Because if we look at the graph on a glance, you might actually think that there is a rapid fall in newspaper circulation, because it dropped quite a lot from here all the way down into here. But if we look at the numbers instead, it actually didn't fall that much. It started off at around 1.5 million and dropped to around 1.25 million. So it only dropped around 250k, which isn't a lot considering this is in millions. So it exaggerates the fall in newspaper circulation. That essentially is what the graph is doing.